Hey, good afternoon, everybody. It is Friday. I know we normally would do weather school on Thursday, but yesterday the governor was speaking at this same moment, so we moved it to today. So hopefully a lot of you are watching. If you're watching over Facebook and you're seeing it, please share the link so your friends will see that we're going to be doing weather school here today as well. Want to cover some interesting topics today. Let's take a look. Number one, we have our feature today, and it's all about hurricanes. So if you like to learn about hurricanes, today's your day. Also, what makes the sky blue? I've been asked that question every week, so we're going to touch on that a little bit today, but I'll go ahead and tell you that next week we're going to make it our feature, and we're going to go all out with a lot of detail about that too. Also, what is the latest frost? A timely thing, because this is the time of year we often see it. What's the latest we've ever had snow in the Piedmont? How active will this hurricane season be? Why is the beach so windy? And what about twin tornadoes? Those are just some of the topics that we've got to cover today. And again, we're going to get started with our feature, and our feature today is all about hurricanes. First of all, let's go back to how they get started. It all starts with the tropics. In the tropics, we have thunderstorms, just like we do over land. But the thunderstorms that we get here over land, oftentimes they will rain themselves out. The rain will fall to cool the air, and the thunderstorm will fall apart. Sometimes they will just keep on moving into a favorable environment and they'll last for a little longer, but usually they'll still fall apart at nighttime. But over the ocean, on the other hand, when the water is warm, greater than 80 degrees, and there's low wind shear, that means light winds blowing into it to disturb it, it's able to maintain itself. And the oceans don't cool off at night. The oceans pretty much stay the same. And so that fuel is still there, so these storms continue to maintain themselves, and if they get stronger, they get classified as a tropical depression storm and then a hurricane. And then, of course, once they make it onto land, they no longer have that warm water source to work with, so they begin to weaken. So that's the basic principles of how they get started. But here are the steps to a hurricane. You start with a generic thunderstorm that can grow into a depression if it becomes organized. Wind speeds up to 38 miles per hour, it can be classified as a depression. Once that wind speed hits 39 miles per hour, it's then called a tropical storm. From 39 up to 73, that's the cutoff. That is for sustained constant winds. You can have gusts that are higher, but those are tropical storm force winds to make it a tropical storm. Once the wind speed hits 74 or higher, it is then reclassified to a hurricane. Those are the steps. What about the strongest? Now, this may surprise some folks because we all think about storms like Katrina, which made the news for all the devastation they caused on the Gulf Coast. But the strongest landfalling hurricanes, Katrina is actually not in that list. It was a real strong storm in the Gulf, but by the time it made landfall, it had lost some of that wind. The top wind speed was way back in 1935. And I believe, and a lot of folks believe, in the 1700s and 1800s, there would have been hurricanes every bit as strong, maybe even stronger, that we just don't have the documentation for. But records became much better in the early 1900s and up into the current time. So 1935 is still the strongest landfalling hurricane, and it was on Labor Day. So, of course, that was in early September. And the second strongest was Hurricane Karen in 1962, and Camille was tied with that at 175. Andrew is the number four. Don't have a number three because you got number two. You got two of those. So you got one, two, and three are tied. And you got number four is Andrew, 1992, 165, and that's the one that hit the Miami area, the south side of Miami, and then it went back across the Gulf and hit the Gulf Coast as well. But it hit Florida with the strongest winds. Hurricane Michael, just a couple of years ago, also hit Florida with winds at 160. Now, what about North Carolina? We'll take a look at this information. The strongest to make landfall for North Carolina was Hurricane Hazel. It made landfall on the North Carolina-South Carolina border. It came in just on the north side of North Myrtle Beach, slammed throughout southeastern North Carolina. Winds were 133. Now, what was unique about Hazel is it was moving rapidly. It was moving at over 50 miles per hour. Most hurricanes move at like 10 to 15 miles per hour. So this moved so quickly that it got deep inland before it could weaken a lot. So we had 100 plus mile per hour winds throughout most of eastern and parts of east central North Carolina. So we had a lot of wind damage from that storm. Now, Outer Banks Hurricane in 1899 is the second strongest at 120 mile per hour winds at landfall. And the interesting note I learned about this when I was researching it, this is also the longest surviving storm. 40 days is how long the life of that storm was out in the Atlantic. So that storm had a long life. There were three other storms tied at 115 miles per hour that hit North Carolina, including now I'm having a Hurricane Fran. See, I'm doing live TV. Sometimes that happens to you. Now, a lot of you are wondering, what about Hurricane Hugo that was so bad? Hurricane Hugo was actually stronger than these, but it did not make landfall on the North Carolina coast. It made landfall on the South Carolina coast, and that was in 1989, but it did cause a lot of damage in this part of North Carolina. The western Piedmont had a lot of wind, but it does not get classified as a North Carolina landfalling hurricane since it was South Carolina. Now, how about the peak of the season? Well, right now we are not into May yet, and of course you don't really see anything showing up yet. Once we get to June 1 is when the hurricane season starts, and that's when you start to see it spike up a little bit and stays kind of flat. And then once we get to early August, it really jumps. So that is the frequency of the average number of storms that you get. And if you look back in history, you can see that we do see it jump up early, and then it kind of flattens out, maybe even goes down a little bit, and then it starts to go back up. And I point that out because every hurricane season, if we get something early and then we get a lull for like 2 months, which is normal, people go, well, this season's not all that bad. And that's a sense of security, I guess, people get, that they think it's not going to be a bad season, but they forget the fact that it really does start to ramp up the beginning of August. And then it peaks as we go into September, and the actual peak is around September 10th. And then we come back down at about the same rate. Once you get to October, it really starts to drop. Now here in North Carolina, we've had some bad hurricanes in October. We had Hurricane Hazel in 1954. A few years ago, we had Hurricane Matthew. But normally we don't have much activity in October. In October, most of it is down toward the Caribbean and areas well south of us. And by the time they can get this far north, there's usually a front or a jet stream that pushes them on out to sea. So it's very rare that we see them here linger past September. September is usually our last really hot month for it, and then the activity really drops off. All right, now, staying on the theme, I want to take some kid questions, and these young folks here, I want to make sure you can see them really good in front of a tractor, and we are looking at Andrew and William Mitchell. So that's Andrew, that's Mitchell, and Frank Morgan Elementary School, first grader for Andrew. And why is the eye wall so dangerous in a hurricane? Well, here's a picture of a satellite of what it would look like from outer space. And this is color enhanced, and the colors are based on the temperature of the cloud tops, which usually indicates how tall the cloud top is. And then you notice right in the middle, it goes right back to being basically not much of anything. And a lot of times you can see the ground because it's clear. But all around it, you've got what's called the eye wall. Here's another view of the eye wall there, of a photograph that's taken from outer space with a visible satellite. You can actually see it, and it's very thick. The planes will fly into it. It gets very rough, and then all of a sudden it gets calm. Basically what happens, the worst part of the storm is in the eye wall. It contains the strongest winds and surrounds the eye. The eye is calm and clear with sinking air. So the air sinks there, but all around it is lifting and spinning, and you do get the most ferocious winds in that part of the storm. This is Josiah Stanley. He's 10 years old, a student at Lake Crest Academy, fourth grade. And his question is, how are hurricane categories determined? Well, let's take a look at those. It is determined based on the actual wind speed. Now, of course, we mentioned earlier, we start with a tropical depression, and then we get to tropical storm once the winds reach 39 miles per hour or higher, up to 73. Once we hit 74, I know it says 75 on here, but once we get to 74, up to 95, we're at a Category 1 hurricane. So they have some damage. They can have tremendous flooding. You can have a lot of flooding from tropical depressions and tropical storms too. But Category 1 hurricanes will cause some damage. Category 2 hurricanes, which is a more common type of hurricane we get on the North Carolina coast. We get our Category 1s and 2s more often than any other. And of course, most other areas get those more frequently as well. They cause some extensive damage. And then once you get up to the Category 3, which is getting up into the ones that are some of our most powerful that we have had here, that's 111 to 129, and those are devastating damage. Now, that Hurricane Hazel I showed you that hit North Carolina was a Category 4. Hurricane Hugo was a Category 4 when it hit South Carolina. Of course, when it came through North Carolina, it had lost some of that wind, but it still had 90 mile per hour winds close to Charlotte. But that's catastrophic damage. And then, of course, the worst is a Category 5, and it's also catastrophic damage. So you don't want to see any of those. But most seasons, we see some of these impacting some parts of the United States. In some years, it is North Carolina. All right, Holly Ferguson from Louisville asks, how active will this hurricane season be? That's a really good question. I've got two sources that have put out forecasts so far for the hurricane season. One that's been doing it for a long time, and that's Colorado State University. And the season begins June 1 and ends on November 30th. Now, granted, some years, about maybe one out of three or one out of four, we'll actually get a storm in May. And then we sometimes can get one to linger past. But the whole season, including the weeks around the official start, their projections are for 16 named storms. In an average season, we have 12. They also project 8 hurricanes. A normal season, we have 6. They're projecting 4 major, and a normal season, we have 3. So they are projecting an above normal season. Another school that also is now issuing hurricane outlooks is my school, where I attended, North Carolina State University. And NC State has gotten even more aggressive on this coming season. They're projecting, they don't have a fine number, there's an 18 to 22 named storms, or 6 to 10 above average. They're projecting 8 to 11 hurricanes, or 2 to 5 above average, and 3 to 5 major. So that would be if it's 3, it's normal, and if it's 5, it's 2 more than normal. So the major hurricanes would be storms that have winds greater than 111 miles per hour. That would be sustained winds. And gusts, you can usually add another 10-15% on top of that number, so what potential gusts could be. All right, Lexus C, 5th grade, Southwood Elementary in Lexington, asks, how long does it take to forecast the weather? All right, this is a fun one to answer. First of all, on a typical day, to actually put the weather forecast together from looking at all the models takes anywhere from 30 to 60 minutes. Some situations are more complicated, takes a lot more deep diving. But on a typical day, let's say like today, today took about 30, 35 minutes to actually formulate the forecast. And then after that, you work on graphics for 1 to 2 hours. And then we also do other things like web content, closed captioning. And so those are all production to put together what we then show on television. So that gives you an idea of the time that we're looking at. All right, Isabella Ferguson from Louisville asks, what is the latest frost and snow, and how long have I done the weather? I'm not sure if I want to answer that part on the bottom because it dates me a little bit, but I will anyway. Let's take a look first of all at the latest frost. It was May 9th of 1989. It also came, ironically, just a few days after a really bad tornado hit Forsyth County. A lot of times when you have that much cold air coming in the spring, it's usually going to be encountered beforehand with some violent weather because it takes a strong front to bring that kind of cold air mass down. So in 1989, we did have a freeze on May the 9th. Now, your question was the latest frost, and there's not documentation for the latest frost because that varies, and they don't record it the same way. They do record the latest freeze, and that's when the temperature hits 32. But the soil can be colder than that air. So typically, I would believe that the latest frost could run as much as 2 weeks later than the latest freeze. So maybe around May 15th to May 20th could be maybe, I'd say, around the latest possible frost. But the freeze is documented, and that was May the 9th. All right, latest snow. I remember this one well. April 18, 1965. It actually was my 18th birthday. And that was the latest that we actually had snow reported at Piedmont Triad International Airport. They only recorded a trace, but I know from being here for 30 plus years that people have told me that they saw dustings. And if you have a dusting, that's at least a tenth of an inch of snow. But the airport did not report anything accumulating. I do know that also on that date that the Raleigh area on the same day from the same system had like 1.8 inches of snow at RDU. So they did accumulate and record accumulating snow from that same snow. So that was quite a while back, 1965. Did my first TV weather report in October of 1980. That was 40 years ago this year. I was only 15. I didn't get paid for that one. That was when I made a prediction as a kid for when we'd have our first snow. And I got lucky. I actually got the snow date right. I had predicted December 27th, 1980. And I got invited back on their program, and I ran with that and used it to help me out getting into the TV business. So that was my first experience. My first paid position was actually in high school. I did the weather one Friday night. I was 17, and I filled in when the chief, Skip Waters, who was born in Greensboro, was actually on vacation, and he believed in me and gave me a chance to fill in for him. And then I got a job there when I was in college. All right, Mary Parker, 10 years old, and Mary was a weather kid. St. Pius Catholic School. And her question is lightning and sun temperatures. And hello, Mary, hope you're watching today. Let's take a look. First of all, the temperature of a lightning bolt can reach 53,540 degrees. That's pretty hot. the surface of the sun is 10,000 degrees. A lot of people find it hard to believe that a lightning bolt can be hotter than the sun. Well, technically, it is hotter than the surface of the sun, but it's not hotter than the core of the sun. The core of the sun is approximately 27 million degrees. That's just an amazing thing to even think about. And here's a cross-section of the sun, and you can just look at it. And you've got the different layers of the sun, and of course, you can look over here and see the temperature of those layers. The core of the sun, right here in the middle, is where this particular chart shows over 28 million degrees. And to give you an idea of the size of the sun in relation to the Earth and the size of that core, this is an example of the size of the Earth to scale with the sun. Look how much bigger the sun is. And just look at that little piece right there. You could put a bunch of those in the core. I mean, the core that is so tremendously hot is much, much bigger than the Earth as well. So technically, the surface of the sun and a lightning bolt is hotter. But the core of the sun and any other parts of the sun is hotter. All right, Trip, Virginia, and Vivian, 6 years old, so that would be Trip. And the four-year-old, I'm assuming that must be Virginia, and that must be Vivian. I hope I got it right. I was going by the explanations I got there. St. Paul's Preschool, what makes the sky blue? I have gotten this question every week. So again, this is one we're going to really dive into with a little more science next week. But I'm going to give you the basics here today. Basically, a direct light from the sun without any interruption, without anything filtering it, would be white light. But once it is scattering through the atmosphere, the blue sky is caused by the light scattering. So that's what happens. And here's a way that you could actually test it also. If you had a prism, you could actually have that bright white light coming directly into the prism, and then once it hits it, it begins to separate, and it separates into colors. You can also see this firsthand anytime you see a rainbow. The light that you see on the rainbow is from the sunlight shining through those raindrops. It makes that happen as well. All right, let's look at another one. This young lady right here is Milana Tompkins, Briar Creek Elementary. She's a second grade student in Thomasville. And she asks, why is the beach so windy? So Milana, thank you for your question. Looks like she's at a skating rink there. All right, let's take a look and see what we've got. Here's a look at the beach and the land. What happens on the land is the sun shines, it heats the ground. When the ground warms, that warm air rises. We talked in some lessons a couple of weeks ago about the fact that warm air is lighter than cool air. So you watch a campfire, you see the smoke rises, it doesn't sink. You see and hear about hot air balloons, but you never hear about cold air balloons because they're not going to rise, but the hot air is lighter, so it'll lift the balloon. Well, this warm air does the same thing. When the sun shines on land, it heats it up, and that warm air rises. When that rises, it creates a vacuum, and the air's got to come in from somewhere else. And when you're at the beach, it gets pulled in off the ocean because all the land is still rising because it's so warm. So this cooler air coming in off the ocean comes in, and that's what creates the sea breeze. And it makes it nice when you go to the beach. Most of the time it'll kick in around lunchtime or shortly after lunch. The wind direction without the sea breeze though will determine how efficient and strong your sea breeze is. So that does play a role too. At nighttime, when the land cools, the air will sink. And when the air sinks, the water temperature is staying the same. It's not changing. So once that land gets cooler, the winds will begin to relax. And if the land gets cooler than the ocean, then you'll get a land breeze. And air will blow from land back toward the ocean because over the ocean the air is rising. So that's what kind of gets everything started, is that heat. Wherever the heat is causes the air to rise, and then that causes air to be brought in from other places to replace it. So that's why the ocean is and the beaches are so breezy for a primary reason. Another reason is lack of trees. Here over the Piedmont, wherever you live, there are trees usually around you. And those trees will block the wind some and cause us to lose some of the breeze that we would have without it. If you go to an open field, you notice it's a lot more breezy. Well, when you go to the beach, you go out there, there's nothing. So there's nothing to block that wind. So it just keeps on going. And that's another reason why the ocean and the beach is so breezy. Jayla Thompson, 11 years old, Pilot Elementary School, asked about twin tornadoes. Now I look at this picture and I'm assuming the one on the left is Jayla, but the one on the right looks pretty young too. That might be mom, I don't know. She looks mighty young. But nonetheless, I hope you're watching today. Let's take a look at twin tornadoes. They do happen. A lot of folks wonder, is that a real thing? And yes, it is. Basically, what happens to get twin tornadoes when two tornadoes occur at the same time from a single supercell? Now you can have different supercells and they can both be producing a tornado, but they wouldn't be considered twin. It's got to be from the same cell. And what happens is usually it's because one is weakening and the atmosphere is such that another one is ready to form. So that can happen too. But it's all about the airflow, just with any other storm. However that air is spinning, if there's a lift on that spin, you can get a tornado, and you can have separate spins underneath the same cell to make it possible to get a twin tornado. All right, that concludes this week's Weather Lesson, Weather School. If you'd like to be a part of our future weeks, all we need you to do is send us an email with your question. You send it to weatherschool@wghp.com. We've had a lot of questions over the previous week, so it may be a couple of weeks from now before we can get to your question. But nonetheless, when you do send me your question, I would like, if you would, to include a few more things with it, because some folks don't, and I don't give you the proper credit that I think you deserve. If you can include your last name, it'd be great. So if you can give me your name, including your last name, also tell us where you're from, your hometown, or if you live in a rural area, what county you're in. Also tell us where you go to school, what grade you're in, and we'll include that information. Your age, of course. We want to include all that information, so when your friends see the question, they will say, oh, I know that person, and that'll be a lot of fun for you too. So thanks again for tuning in this week, and we hope to see you again next Thursday. And again, if for any reason we get preempted like we did last week, we will find another moment to get our session on. But hopefully it'll be Thursday of next week at 3 p.m.